al discurso de Samuel David sobre flujos geométricos.
Vale, quiero preguntarlo para Dani, bueno, un dato, un discurso de flujos geométricos. No sé si te lo voy a dar luego en inglés, puesto que en español no es muy bueno. Pero si ustedes tienen algunas preguntas, que sea de motiva, de matemática o de idioma, por favor, que me interrumpan. Y creo que puedo contestar a cuestiones en español, pero... Como lo he dicho. The idea of these minimals is to give you kind of flavor about what are geometric flows, what you can use them for, and what are the main techniques in mathematics you need to actually show things using these minimals, these geometric flows. So we have three lectures. Today part one and two. Part one will be just very short. And part two will be about what is called curve shortening flows. Which is the simplest flow to understand. You start with a curve and make it evolve following some equation. I will explain that. Then, this should be today. Then, before showing in this part, I will give you the main results. I will give you the idea, but I will not give any technical proof because I want you to feel the philosophy of it before entering into some technical details, which sometimes are a bit hard to follow. So today is supposed to be kind of entertaining. Tomorrow, I will start by speaking about parabolic equations, which are the key technical tool we're using when we're dealing with geometric flows. And this parabolic equation allows us to have some result which are called maximum principle. You will see that even though technically sometimes you need some work to show them, they are quite easy to understand. And then I will give you some basics on curvature. So these two parts shall be on Wednesday. Basically, the technical part. And the last part, which should occupy Thursday, will probably be geometric flows. On surfaces, on benefits. And I will also write some lecture notes. The ones for today are already ready. They are on the web page of the MATEM where you found the announcement. Let us start. There is a general philosophy when you're doing Riemannian geometry. Which is that you start with some objects. Which may be a curve, or a surface, or an higher dimension, anything. And on this object, you have some local information. local information, I mean that you have at least two information, you got the metric, which allows you to measure the length, and you have the curvature, which gives you more of a local shape of where you are. And the question is, can we have an idea of general topology? So let me draw a picture. Can you see something if I'm running there? Imagine you're just like a small beetle or an ant, and you're living in some world, you've got your small world, and you would like to know what is exactly the shape of your world. As you see, just seen locally from here, for your small beetle, these two things locally look very the same. And you cannot detect, a priori, there is no obvious way to detect the fact from the curvature that there is a hole or that there is no hole on your actual living room. So you can make the same analogy for us. We know since Einstein that we're living in a universe which is at least 4D, and we of course cannot see in 4D. And we will be interested in knowing what is the shape and the topology of our universe. But the only knowledge we have is the very local knowledge. Okay? So, the idea of all what I'm going to tell you is develop some tool so that starting from very local knowledge, you can have some global information. So, you know that these two, in terms of topology, are the same, they're just spheres. Okay? So, but the question in terms of local geometry is, how can I know that these two are the same? And this is for moving to speed. Well, there is a very natural idea, which is just to start with your world which maybe have a strange shape, and work so that you deform it. And you finish with one which you know. So, there is two. This is a good idea, because if you can do that, you're sure you will have the same global topology. But this leads to two questions. The first one is, how can you deform it? And the second one is, how can you be sure? That at the end, we have a sphere. And I remind you that we only have local information. So, Let us start with answering the second question by Ethereum, which is one of the oldest of remaining geometry, which is due to Newton. If S is an orientable, surface with constant curvature, I think most of you know what is the curvature of the surface. If you don't, it doesn't matter, I will tell you this later. Well, there are three possibilities. If the curvature is constant and zero, then the surface is a torus. If the curvature is positive, then it's a sphere. And the last one, if the curvature is negative, then it's a surface of genus at least 2, which means that you have something like bristle with at least 2 moons. So, this is exactly the kind of result I'm looking for. I only have a local information, which is the curvature, and this gives me a global knowledge about what is the topology of my surface. So, this also gives me an idea about the first question. How can I deform something so that I know at the end what is the topology? Well, there's a natural way, which is try to make the curvature constant. As you can see, the whole idea of geometric flows is this. Start with something and try to make its curvature constant. And this is the whole idea. Then you have technical points which need some care. But the whole philosophy is there. Yeah, if my writing is not readable, please tell me. This happens. So, before going to the case of surfaces, I'm going to tell you about the case of curves, which is simpler, at least to understand. So, let me present you a very simple question of topology. You take a surface, which is just a cylinder. So a cylinder is a product of a circle by R. And now I take a curve. Close. means, well, it's closed, which is embedded, which means that it has no source intersection. Okay. I want to know whether, let me draw one so that you have a clear dot. So you see these curves? It's down there, behind, before, behind, and so on, and come back. And the simple question I want to know is the curve contractible? Which means, can I shorten it so that it becomes a point, or is it making a turn around the cylinder? So, as you see, when you start with any curve, the answer might not be that obvious. So the idea is still the same. We are going to deform the curve so that it becomes as short as possible. And if it is contractible, by doing that, it will just collapse to one. So one hope that at the end of the process there will be a solution, either the curve collapse either at the end you should have something like a geodesic. Which is in the cylinder case, just a circle. So, still the question is, how can you do that? So the first idea which was developed which is called polygonal shortening. It's the following idea. You'll start with your curve. You take two points. And you replace. This is your gamma. And you replace the portion of the curve in between by a straight line, if you're in the plane, or by a geodesic. As you can believe, if you do it that way, you might lose some information on the topology. So you replace the portion of your gamma by this straight line. And then you do it again. So what do we get? Well, first you start with that, then we'll have something Then you do it again there. Then you do it again there. And so. So. There are several difficulties in doing that. One is, how do you choose the point where it gets? Okay. The second problem, which is much more tricky, is during this process, if you want, for instance, to enter this question, you should not modify the topology. And this is not that easy, because if your curve, if your initial curve, is doing something like that, maybe with a bad choice, and you mentioned that you have a hole in your surface there, with a bad choice of your cutting point, you're going to cut there. And if you're doing that, you've lost the topological information. And the last problem is to know whether this process converges. Have been dealt with. There are some papers where they have well defined some methods so that you're sure that everything works. But it's very difficult. And so, this curve shortening flow was introduced to replace this idea by something which is actually simpler.
You mean in the problem one, the x and y are in, on the curve?
Yes. So, you don't have that. So, they are on the curve. You have to tune them close enough so that you're sure not to lose topology. And you do the first step, and then you will do some other one. The problem is that the process will depend on the way you choose the points where you get. So you have to define a way so that you can deal with the two other problems. So, next idea which I'm going to explain you with more details is this curve shortening flow. So, the idea is very basic. If you start with something like that, how do you want to deform it? Well, you want this to go out, and this to go in, and so on. So that it becomes as round as possible. Okay? Some may guess that a good notion to distinguish between this point which is good, which should go in, and this one which should go out, is the curvature of the curve. So let me remind you why the curvature of the curve. I start with the closed curve, which is parameterized. By R max. This means that the speed vector has normal length. I will call n gamma of s, which will be a vector in this point gamma of s. So that's the tangent vector and this vector is an orthonormal base. So you get your surface, it's something like that. You get your curve. Take a point. You got the tangent vector, and you get the normal. So the curvature of gamma at the point gamma of s is, I will write it k gamma of s. It's the number such that when the derivative of the tangent vector with respect to s is this number times the normal. So to justify this definition, you have to show that this is parallel to normal, so you just have to show that it's perpendicular to the tangent vector, and it's not difficult, it just comes from the fact that your tangent vector has constant speed. So this is curvature. And now, what is curve shortening? So, now we're going to take. So, the family of curves. We have a smooth family . So I've chosen parameter u instead of s because it may not be parameterized by arcness. I don't mind, it doesn't matter. Okay. So I have a family of curve. We say that it is a solution of the curve shortening curve. I will often write CSF, not to write curve shortening curve 10 times. If I'm in here, we have a following for all. The derivative of the position gamma t of u with respect to t is equal to the curvature of the curve gamma t at point gamma t of u times the normal vector. once again, this is exactly the picture I had made before. When the curvature is that way, it means that it's pointing inwards, and when it's that way, it's pointing outwards. So this reflects the good idea of learning. And when you have something which is already convex, it will point all that way. Which gives you the idea that if you start with a circle which is contractible, it will just collapse like. Well, we're going to continue the evolution of the length of the curve. So, the solution is the following. Some of you may have done already in Riemannian geometry. So you have gamma t. It's most of you here. And to simplify the condition, I suppose that gamma 0 is parameterized by R. So now I will go x of gamma 0, which will just be the derivative of gamma 2. So what this means, to start with your gamma 0, and you make it move, so you will have some vector which gives you deformation. This is the infinitesimal deformation of the curve. Then, the derivative of the length is given by minus the integral of 0 to gamma 0. Remember, my curve is parameterized by R length. Of the scalar product between this vector x and the vector which is exactly this one. In particular, if my x, which is a variation, is a solution for the curve shortening flow, Well, the Kirchhoff-Newton flow is exactly defined so that this x is this vector. And the norm of this vector is going up because it's just of norm 1. But that is the minus. So you can see that the length is decreasing. Something else which you can see is that your curve is a geodesic, the initial one. So what is geodesic? It's something which is locally a minimum or eventually a maximum. It's a critical point for the length. It's a curve which you can locally either definition. So if you want to have a critical point for the length, you need this to be orthogonal to x or any x. So the only solution for this to be zero. So finding the geodesic is just finding a curve with constant curvature being zero. So now we're happy. We have a good solution to deform our curve, and the curve and the length is decreasing. So it should either collapse or go to the geodesic. But there are still many mathematical problems. Well, the first one. That this equation has a solution. When you start with a smooth curve. Once you have shown carefully that it has a solution, then you want to show. And it converges either to points or either it goes to the geodesic. Why can you hope that? Well, let me draw the visual intuition for this flow.
In the problem one, the which is given, the curvature function with respect to t?
This is given.
Gamma zero?
Gamma zero is given. And you want to find a family of gamma t, starting in gamma zero, following this equation.
Okay, the curvature is not given.
Well, only the curvature of gamma zero, but for the rest, it's evolving with the curve.
It means also it's possible to find what kind of deformations of the curvature can.
Yes, exactly. This will be the key point. I will come to that.
Okay.
So the idea is that you can have at least three cases. The first one. When you start with a contractible curve, which you don't really know, and it will shrink. And the other, another situation you want, and you hope it works, okay? You start with your curve on the cylinder. what is the idea of the proof of that?
So who's the second author in the 86 paper?
It's Gage.
Oh, okay. G-A-G. And by explode, you mean it doesn't tend to infinity?
In at least some point.
Yeah.
So you can see, for instance, here, the curvature is exploding everywhere, because the curvature of the circle of radius r is 1 over r. Here, the curvature is just exploding in that very point. And in the last picture I had drawn with the geodetic, the curvature is not exploding at all. So, the idea of cooling. If you've got a family which is part of the trace, by arc length, which is technically a bit tricky, because then the length of the interval of definition will move around the deformation, but it's easier to do some definition. If I rewrite this thing, what's this? Well, it's the derivative with respect to S of the tangent vector. And the tangent vector itself is the derivative with respect to S of the position. So this looks a lot like a heat equation. I will come back to that. A heat equation is exactly when you have something which depends on space and on time, and the derivative with respect to time is the sum of the derivative with respect to all the space variables. Here it is not a heat equation, because gravity has value in a 2D space and you have only one parameter. I will come back to that. So, in terms of PDE theory, this means that this is called a weakly parabolic. And this is kind of hard to solve. So, this theorem by Hamilton was one of the, we will see the same for Richardson, it was one of the main discoveries, which is how to solve some special kind of weakly parabolic equations, which are these. So we know the flow exists for a small time, but still it doesn't answer the question, because we want it to exist for a long time and to understand its limits. Okay. So the following theorem, which is due to Grayson. Is looking at the evolution of the curvature, because in this statement it says that if the curvature stays bounded, everything is fine. So the key thing is to know how does the curvature evolve. Start with the solution of the curvature of the flow. You know it exists at least for some time. And then the curvature satisfies the following. which might be penetrated by objects on the line, it doesn't matter. Is the second derivative with respect, it doesn't matter. Plus some other terms, plus the curvature itself to the power of 3, plus some factor times the curvature with where this factor.
So that answers the previous question of how the curvature was
exactly. Yeah.
If galaxy
has curvature which explodes somewhere. Such that there exists a point in which the curve is parameterized by just by omega 0 to 1. If there exists a point with the limit when you approach t of the curvature, which goes to infinity, then this is the case for all points. And the curve is collapsing and you know more than it's collapsing, you know that it's contained in a disk of radius some constant time c minus. So you really have a family of disks. Not your disks. And all is contained in a small disk and it's collapsing at the same time. And I will stop here for today. In particular, it shows that you cannot have just one singularity appearing somewhere. Either it goes to GZ, either everything is collapsing in the same. And he even shows more, he showed that it's not only contained in a circle, it's going closer and closer to a circle. It becomes round when it collapses. Thank you.
Well, let's thank someone for... No sé si tienen alguna pregunta, comentario, cualquier duda. Muchas gracias por la entrada. Si no tienen ninguna o lo que se les ocurre, las notas están en línea con todo lo que vio hoy. Si van a la página del IMATE, donde está el anuncio de la plática del día de hoy, en esa liga, ahí ya pusimos la liga donde están las notas, ¿no? Pues el video subirá, no sé, la semana que viene. Pues seguro nadie tiene ninguna pregunta.
¿Qué pasaba con el asunto este de que la familia fuera encajada?
Alright, so I forgot to say this is part of this camera, right? If gamma 0 is omitted, it stays. So it still was studying the curvature evolution. You have to do something to show that if you start with your curve which is like that, and holding so that you have this, it's not possible with the evolution of the curvature. And with the equation you get, it's not trivial, but it's part of the theorem.
Is there any relation between the flow that is associated with the geodesics, the geodesic flow, and this curve sharpening flow?
So, yes and no. The point is, these two flows don't exactly work, live in the same world, because what is the geodesic flow? You start with a vector, you have the vector x, you look at the geodesic which is tangent to x, and you go to time t, okay. And this will be 5 C of X. So a priori, you will say there is nothing to link there. This is the flow on vectors, and the other one is the flow on curves. Okay. It happens that there are some relationship. In particular, you can try to when you're on the curve, which you can look at it as a single metric space, it's just a curve. So on this, you have the geometries. It's all geometries, so your vector is flowing there. And when the curve changes of shape, you're going to want to know how does change the flow. And in particular, how does change the speed of the flow, how does change the time you need to come back, and so on. And so there are interesting things to do about with there. I will think about that. I will speak about them in the last lecture on surfaces, because it's more interesting to see the link with geometric flows on surfaces and geodesic flow. Because on the curve, you see the geodesic flow on a single curve is not very interesting. You can only make some turns around the curves. So you'll see it's easier to answer your question when you're doing some geometric flow on surface than this curve.
Can I just say, it is a very interesting question, and there are people that are working on that. Glass, Macra, and Niebuhr's use curve shaping flow to study the geodesic flow in the two turns. So there's recent work that uses these two. So this is what I'm going to do. ¿Alguien más tiene otra pregunta? La pueden hacer en español. O sea, Samuel sí entiende perfecto español, nada más que para que sea más rápida la exposición de esta semana.
Bueno, el último corolario te dice de alguna manera que puedes evitar, como dice, las singularidades. O sea, si ya las tienes en algún disco, puedes hacer algo.
As I mentioned, sí. Sí se puede.
You can answer in English if you want. But...
So, we'll speak about that. When you are in higher dimension, you want to do more or less the same. Imagine you start with your sphere, which might have some strange shape. Well, when the curvature is being inward, you want to go inward. And when the curvature is being outward, you want to go outwards. Okay? So now, imagine that you have something which has that shape. It's still like a sphere. But you have a very short neck. Okay. So your flow will want to make this opening. But this is smooth, so it will want to make this one short. As you imagine, there is kind of a fight between this influence and this one. So what can happen is the following very disturbing thing. Sometimes you have a singularity which I have here. But after the singularity, if you try to run again the flow, they will just split like soap bubbles. Okay. So, and so when you want to understand topology, this is a big problem. But we'll see that on the last lecture on Thursday. This does not happen. Neither for surfaces. The theorem I have stated say it does not happen for curves. And unfortunately it does happen. For rigid physics. in dimension 3 and height. And maybe some of you have heard of Perelman, who had the film model in 2006. He did use this eye of geometric flow to show the Poincaré conjecture, which is that you can have closed three manifolds without any fundamental group, that is a sphere. And when Hamilton introduced this flow, he was already hoping he could solve the Poincaré conjecture with that. And the problem he could not deal with is exactly the apparition of these singularities. And this he could not deal with. And the extremely powerful eye of Perelman is so that you make what he calls surgery. So you should not wait until the singularity appears, but just before, you cut it at least. And try to make it in a controlled way. Because it's good to have the idea, but then you have to show it works. And once you've done that, carry on with the flow on the two pieces. And using that, show this one kind of conjecture, and even stronger. But I will not explain the technical aspects of Bitcoin 3 because it takes a lot of time. So tomorrow I will explain the technical tools we need to have some idea. I will not do all the computation, don't worry. And on Thursday I will explain what happens for surfaces, which is more interesting.
¿Alguien tiene algún otro caso?
En español.
Vale.
Esta situación de que el flujo converja a curvas geodésicas cerradas o a puntos fijos impone algún tipo de restricción sobre la dinámica del flujo en términos de grandes hermosas main, por ejemplo, y todas las todo el tipo de recurrencia que presente sea o periódico.
Sí, exactamente. Y so the idea of why you should look at this shortening curve flow is exactly what you said, to study the space which I can notice. Of the space of all those curves on the surface. So you've got this space and you've got this flow, and showing that is exactly saying that in some sense, the only critical points you can get for this flow are just points or geodesics. And so for instance, one of the applications, which was historically the first motivation, application it's a very funny theorem, which says that if you get any metric, on the sphere, so maybe something quite strange, then there are at least three closed tubes. So here you can see there is like one here, and one here. That's when the metric is kind of tricky, it's not obvious. So the idea is, like you say, you look at this space and you want to study the topology of this space, and you do some more theory to do that. And the function you're going to look at is kind of the gradient for the Lambs function, which is given by this.
Who is that? Why is that Bangert?
Where's the original proof? I don't know. So, in the paper by Grayson, which is in the Lamont in the 1889, he's showing this, he was the first to show it using the curve shop. And that is something. And the first proof of this is by using what I have told you at the beginning, which is this idea of cutting the curve to the with polygons so that you're showing it. It was the first one showing it.
¿Es alguna otra pregunta? Le agradecemos una vez más a Samuel, muchas gracias a ustedes.